Every second, every minute, and every day, someone is impacted by mental illness. Mental health affects us all. On this episode of Let's Talk Cincy, we're breaking down the stigmas of mental health with real conversations. From teen suicide.
We need to talk about suicide. We need to talk about good mental health. And it's okay to say, I'm struggling and I need help. And that's my message to these kids and even the young adults.
Complex links between social media and your mental health.
There are so many outlets and publications that really fail to adequately respond to the advent of the internet.
Plus, changing the conversation of mental health in the church, how some psychologists are working to change how the sick are healed.
From WLWT, this is Let's Talk Cincy.
Well, we're shining the spotlight on mental illness to help start a conversation that will hopefully save lives. Hello, my name's Alexis Rogers.
And I'm Curtis Fuller. You know, one of the growing problems is teenage suicide. It is happening at several local high schools already this year. The CDC says the problem is only getting worse. Suicide, get this, is the third leading cause of death for young people between the ages of 10 and 24.
And about 4,600 kids will die this year, and another 157,000 will be treated in emergency rooms for self-inflicted injuries. We talked to a Northern Kentucky mother who is helping others struggling with harmful thoughts after the death of her own son, Ethan.
The family has made it their mission to raise awareness about good mental health and suicide prevention through the foundation Ethan's Purpose.
Ethan was my 16-year-old son that took his own life in September, and one of his favorite passions was basketball. Never take your eye off the ball. Ethan had reached out to us and had attempted suicide several times, and he had a counselor. He spent time at a inpatient facility. He had a workout trainer. And I felt like he was okay, and I felt like I took my eye off the ball.
Ethan Zagara was an 11th grade student at Connor High School. Basketball was more than just a game for the teenager. It was his joy in a world filled with anxiety and depression. Debbie Zagara is now using her son's love of basketball to help spread a powerful message.
There's a bigger purpose here that we're serving. We need to talk about suicide. We need to talk about good mental health. And it's okay to say, I'm struggling and I need help. And that's my message to these kids and even the young adults. It's okay to not have everything figured out. The key is asking for help.
This 3-on-3 basketball tournament was a fundraiser to support a foundation Debbie and her family started called Ethan's Purpose.
Your child may not tell you everything that you feel like you need to know. It's okay to ask for professional help. It's okay to say my child needs help. That was hard for me to accept, but it's okay. And I realize now that there may have been nothing I could have done to stop it, but I didn't stay on top of it like I feel like I should have. So as a parent, I would suggest your child's always gonna need you. Your child's always gonna need your support, even if you feel like they're doing okay. And then for the kids, it's okay to need help and it's okay to see a counselor.
Former NKU basketball star and Horizon League Player of the Year, Drew McDonald, is Ethan's cousin.
I had a pair of shoes I put the suicide awareness ribbon on just to honor him, and I had a ribbon in my locker with him, and I prayed to him before every game, and the signature moment of my career, I would say, would be when I hit that last second shot. And I told Aunt Debbie right after the game, she was in attendance, I said he was with me on that shot.
We started the foundation Ethan's Purpose to help provide supports to the school systems, whether it's counseling, social emotional curriculums, small group counseling, and in order to fund it, we needed to do fundraisers, so it naturally was a fit to partner with Drew and put on a 3-on-3 tournament.
Person, maybe at times Ethan was kind of lost and didn't think people loved him as much, but at an event like this, you see how much people actually care for you and how much they want to support you. And that's just the message we're trying to get across to all the kids out there. Try to spread awareness on mental health and get them the help that they need, and they can see how many people actually care about you with events like this, how many people loved and cared about Ethan.
We all go to the dentist, we all go to the eye doctor. Why not take care of our mental health? There's no shame in that, no shame.
You know, that 3-on-3 basketball tournament actually raised more than $2,600. That money will be used to help support students in several local schools in Boone County. Now, you can join the cause by heading to the Facebook page, Ethan's Purpose.
Now, the numbers are truly staggering when it comes to what the National Institute of Mental Health says. They say that more than 46 million Americans experience some type of mental or behavioral condition like depression and anxiety.
Right, and so we're so happy that we have Dr. Karen Bankston, who's a professor at the University of Cincinnati. And Dr. Bankston, welcome. What's going on, especially with Black folks? One stat I heard was that every 4.5 hours an African American commits suicide, and we also know with young people it's rising.
Well, you know, we see such a change in what's going on in the community right now that we've normalized some behaviors that in the past have not been normalized. And so kids are really still wanting to live the dream, right? They still want to live the dream, and sometimes that dream cannot be a reality for them. The competition that exists when we look at the use of social media indeed is playing a huge role. But at the same time, our neighborhoods and where we live also creates a different kind of competition. Girls still want to be a part of the group.
Right.
Guys still want to be a part of the team. And when it doesn't happen, then it creates a sense of hopelessness and a sense of isolation that is very difficult and challenging for them to get through.
It's amazing to me because we talk about this with parents, right?
Yes.
And depending on which generation you might be from, some say, well, this just wasn't happening when I was a kid. Was it not happening, or are we just talking about it more now?
I think it's a combination of both. It was happening, but we were in an environment, and I'm like a couple of generations before you, so it was happening, but we were of a generation where we said, we're just gonna push through. Mm. And there were places where we could go to push through. The church was one of those places. We don't necessarily have that now because the stigma still exists in our communities.
So we really have to get past that stigma. We need to talk, we need to reach out. There's anxiety, depression.
Yes.
We really need to help our young people.
Yes.
Talk about it.
There's a big difference between anxiety and depression, so we need to understand that. You know, the whole notion of anxiousness really is the fight or flight, if you're familiar with that, where something happens and you really just get scared and you want to get out, and that makes you anxious. Depression is almost the opposite of that. Depression is when you just can't do it. You know, in the old days, we used to call it getting the blues, where you really just, I just can't get out of bed, I just don't want to eat, and it hurts so bad that a lot of the children that are doing suicide or have ideations or belief that they want to kill themselves are trying to get rid of the pain. They're trying to get rid of the pain of the depression, and that's what causes them to
lead
to that.
So I think the key is, let's not do it alone. Don't go it alone.
Absolutely. Yes. And thank you so much for just breaking down this. This is a tough topic, and of course, our thanks to Dr. Bankston for being with us here on Let's Talk Cincy. We'll go ahead and send it back to Curtis.
Well, bringing mental health issues in the music industry and beyond to the forefront, we have a very candid conversation with award-winning writer and commentator Jamila Lemieux when we return on Let's Talk Cincy.
Hi there and welcome back. We are having a very important conversation. This time, we're talking about someone taking on others' mental well-being in the public space.
That is what award-winning writer and well-known commentator Jamila Lemieux is known for doing on a national stage. We talk with her about the impact of speaking out.
Award-winning writer and commentator Jamila Lemieux is known for leading millennial voices around issues of race, gender, and sexuality. Hot topics centered around mental health. Lemieux says it's imperative to challenge the status quo.
Those stories impact how people see the world and how they see themselves. So it's critical that we are a part of that group that are shifting and shaping narratives.
Lemieux uses the same platform that many say can be damaging to mental health to bring issues to light that many times go untalked about.
There are so many outlets and publications that really fail to adequately respond to the advent of the internet, you know, 30 years ago. And some of them are playing catch up now. Some of them have have left us, and others are trying to figure things out.
Lemieux's recent work with the acclaimed Surviving R. Kelly series put a national spotlight on mental health from sexual, racial, and industry perspectives.
Were it not for the dedicated work of Jim DeRogatis and other journalists who have, you know, stayed focused on R. Kelly for, you know, over two decades, I wouldn't have much to say other than, you know, when I was in high school, I remember when he tried to talk to my friend. And I was in middle school, I remember when he tried to talk to this friend of mine. Because there was effort taken to hold this man truly accountable, those of us that do, you know, commentary were able to really help build the case against him.
Lemieux says it takes a community conversation to initiate change.
It's not just the individual, but the culture, you know, against the music industry to say, why haven't we at the very least interrogated why? You know, a 14-year-old artist could record an album called Age Ain't Nothing But a Number with her 27-year-old rumored boyfriend in the background, and for this to be a hit, and for black women and black girls across the country to love, you know, and support that music and the man who's responsible for it. Why did this happen? Why did this go on for so long?
Whether it's taking an approach through media or from person to person in the community, Lemieux says the art of speaking up is imperative to not only survive, but thrive.
It's a skill, you know, and it takes a lot of work. So I wasn't always as confident as I am with sharing my opinions publicly. I didn't always have the language that I have today to do that. This is a matter of taking facts and forming your opinion, you know, in response to those facts and articulating them in the way that hopefully helps to elevate discourse.
Interesting perspective. She says keeping the conversation going is really half the battle.
And then understanding the facts behind it is the other half. And with big movements like the Me Too movement and dissecting big cultural shifting stories, just like working on the R. Kelly case, she hopes that it leaves room for other people's inner truths to come out and be addressed. Destigmatizing mental illness in the church.
Next on Let's Talk Cincy, the relationship between therapy, mental health, and the church. Plus,
the opposite of depression is vitality, or having the will and the energy to do life.
What it looks like to live with mental illness.
We talked to a man living with depression about his journey and the treatment that's helped him find a way forward. Hi there and welcome back. Local church leaders and psychologists are working to change the conversation about mental health in the church.
Joining us today, psychologist and pastor Eric Holley. He is here to talk about the relationship between therapy, mental health, and the church. And first of all, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Karen Bankston sort of touched on this in their previous conversation about this relationship. How did you start walking down this path?
Well, I've been a social worker and a therapist for over 20 years, and I've also been an assistant pastor for the last 15 years. And so this is my passion, really dispelling the myth about mental illness in the church and helping people to understand that you can be saved and have a therapist. That's actually the motto of my counseling practice, Speak Life Counseling Services.
Mm-hmm. It seems like there's been this rift, right? I mean, you have some folks that say, you know, no, you need to go to therapy, that can't be healed in church. And others that say, no, you just need to go to church. Let's have that conversation. I mean, how do the two maybe complement each other? How can they?
It's an integration, and you're right, Alexis. I mean, it's really important to talk about that. If you look at it in the Bible, several of the most prominent biblical characters suffered with mental illness. Elijah, when he had one of his greatest battles, defeating the prophets of Baal, when Jezebel put a hit on his life, he ran away and he thought about suicide. David battled depression. I believe Peter was one of the first ones that was known to have ADHD because he was so impulsive and so rash. And so it's important for people to understand that mental illness has always existed in the Bible and in the church, and we can't sweep it under the rug, nor can we tell people that if you have a mental illness, it means that you don't have faith or that you don't believe God. That's just the opposite. It means that you need help, and there are services that are available to help you.
We're having this conversation now, but have you felt a breakthrough at all? Do you feel that people are accepting that concept that you're saying?
I believe so. I think certainly having programs such as this to talk about it. Again, part of my purpose and my passion is to talk about it on social media. I talk about it a lot in my church about the importance of practicing good mental health. And here's part of the correlation. We certainly talk about the fact that individuals can have a physical illness, diabetes, high blood pressure, cancer, and it's okay to go to a family doctor and to receive medication, but why isn't it okay to have a mental illness and be able to see a therapist or a psychiatrist?
That's what the mom was saying about, you know, her son.
It's exactly. It's the same thing, and so it's important that we understand that, and so the more awareness that we have, the more that that churches talk about it, the better. And here's another interesting statistic. 1 in 4 pastors suffer with depression. Mm. 1 in 4. And so 25% of our pastors suffer with depression. Most of them don't talk about it because they feel it's a weakness and that their church members won't understand. But the more that pastors talk about it, the more that it will resonate with their church goers and that they too will feel the importance to seek help.
You know, that's so important. And I think a couple other things that I find interesting is that 1 in 6 adults in the U.S. are living with mental health issues, and the fear and uncertainty of stigma can be a bit overwhelming.
Yeah, it sure can. Yes. We appreciate you being here,
Thank you,
Eric.
Thank you.
Some are sharing their stories to help others better understand that life can get better. This is Greg's story.
It really is like going from living in black and white to living in color. I have been living with depression for some time, several years. I would say probably it started when I was a teenager, but it manifested very strongly over the past couple of years. What had happened was my brain turned on me and it started lying to me and telling me that life isn't worth living, that I was useless, that I was worthless, and that I was a failure. And that's what depression is. It is your brain telling you that you should be ashamed, you should feel guilty for those failures. And to add to that, the interesting thing about depression is, well, with any mental illness, you can't make your brain do something it doesn't want to do, right? And that's the challenge. You can't will yourself out of depression. I tried. Another misnomer about depression is that its opposite is happiness. And that's not the case. The opposite of depression is vitality, or having the will and the energy to do life, right? So when people come around, they want you to be happy. They want you to feel happy because it makes them uncomfortable. So as a depressed person, when I was living with depression, when I was in full-on depression, I would do my best to make them feel better. In turn, I was lying to myself and feeling like a failure because I wasn't happy, because people would come and try to cheer me up, and I would do my best, but it just made me feel worse. And what I really needed was someone to sit next to me and say, I understand where you are. The turning point was about midway through my transcranial magnet stimulation. What that involves is sitting in a chair and having a coil placed on your head about here, and they use very strong magnets. It's not painful, but it does feel, it's irritating. It's kind of like getting a tattoo if you've ever had one. It's that kind of irritation. And you sit in the chair for about 18 to 20 minutes with pulses that last about 10 seconds, 10 to 15 seconds every minute. I went through several medications that didn't work, and then I eventually got on a medication that worked in the beginning and stopped working. I also took some time to find the right therapist. I went through about 4 therapists before I found the right one, and that really made a difference. What I think matters is having hope and having a support system and having people around you who know what you're going through. Now I can experience those things like anticipatory joy. Now I seek out my friends and ask them, you know, what are you doing? Why don't we go to dinner? Why don't we go shopping, do something fun? It gets better. I know that sounds canned, but it does get better. Reach out, find books. There are tons of resources. You can call a suicide helpline. You don't have to be suicidal. You can call to ask for help with that regard. If you know someone who has depression, or you think someone might have depression, it's always good to reach out.
If you or someone you know needs help, there are many ways to reach out. The Suicide Prevention Hotline is 1-800-273-TALK. That's 8255. You can also text 4HOPE to 741-741.
Well, coming up, Mason High School in the national spotlight over its new policy.
Next on Let's Talk Cincy, why they say getting rid of their valedictorian and salutatorian recognition will help their students' mental health. Welcome back to Let's Talk Cincy. Now to a decision that has a lot of people fired up all across social media. I saw this quite a bit on my timeline. Mason High School is doing away with a valedictorian and salutatorian recognition beginning next year.
This decision is part of a larger effort to reduce stress and anxiety for students. WLWT News 5's Helena Battipaglia explains why some students think the change will be best for everyone.
We should have fun in high school and not just try to push ourselves to the max.
Ryan Griffith has always strived to be a well-rounded student. He's on the lacrosse team, he swims, and is even a Hope Squad member, helping classmates who may struggle with mental health issues.
I definitely think those have really changed my life into a positive way and kind of built my personality and my character.
He says the stresses of academic achievement often deter students from pursuing their own passions and being the best they can be. It's why he's on board with Mason High School's newest decision, eliminating valedictorian and salutatorian recognition.
I think in the long run, it's really going to change the atmosphere of the school in a positive way.
The decision has stirred up a lot of criticism on social media, with hundreds weighing in on our WLWT Facebook page. What's wrong with trying to have the best GPA? One person commented. Another, just call the entire class up and give everyone a participation ribbon. Associate Principal Shauna Bumiller is aware of the mixed opinions, but says many other schools nationally are doing the same thing.
What it means to be happy and what it means to be successful, and really it's not just about the grade, but it's about the whole child.
She says the move is part of the school's larger effort to reduce anxiety, depression, and instances of suicide.
It comes from, you know, feeling inadequate, the chase.
Griffith and Bumiller think there's nothing wrong with some healthy competition, but say obsessing over being the best needs to change.
Just taking off that stress, knowing, hey, if it comes to the final and I get a B, it's okay.
Well, that's an interesting discussion there. You know, and I tell you now, school officials say they will still recognize students who achieve high honors just in other ways.
And the high school is also changing the way it calculates GPAs beginning next year as well. So the goal here is to encourage students to take the classes that interest them instead of loading up on advanced placement classes to improve their academic standing.
Well, thank you for joining us for this edition of Let's Talk Cincy. You can always catch up on any of the shows 24/7.
Just visit WLWT.com, click on the menu tab next to the station logo, and you'll find Let's Talk Cincy tab two-thirds of the way down to the left of the navigation bar. So, hey, hang out with us.
Yeah. We'll see you next week. Have a good night.